There is the clerk here, there's a court reporter, and there is some IT support that is also on the line. This is the date and time set for an initial appearance. The reason we're holding this hearing remotely via Zoom is due to a order that's been issued by the Supreme Court. In that order, it designates that whenever plausible, hearings are to be held remotely in order to effectuate safety of society and effectuate safety of all employees in the courtroom. In future proceedings, it will be an issue that's addressed case by case and hearing by hearing. That order is dated April 22nd, 2020, and has been issued by the Idaho Supreme Court. Mr. Daybell, do you read, speak, and understand the English language?
Yes.
Mr. Daybell, can you hear me okay today?
Yes.
Mr. Daybell, it appears that you have hired private counsel, Mr. John Pryor, is that correct?
Yes.
And you'd like to retain him. Mr. Pryor, has there been a formal notice of appearance that has been entered?
Judge, I will get that filed within a short period of time.
All right, but Mr. Daybell, Mr. Pryor is your attorney for this hearing, is that correct?
Yes.
Mr. Daybell, have you seen a notification of rights form that was provided to your counsel prior to the hearing here today?
Yes.
Do you understand all of your legal rights?
Yes.
Mr. Daybell, in addition to the rights that were contained in that notification of rights form that was given to you, I'm going to advise you of additional rights under Idaho Criminal Rule 5. Number one, you have the right to be at the initial appearance or appear via Zoom remotely like you are today. You don't need to make any statements today. You have the right to know what charges are being brought against you. You have the right to bail. You have the right to counsel. And you have all of the other rights that have been presented to you in that notification of rights. Do you have any questions about your rights, Mr. Daybell? I didn't hear your answer.
No. He just not.
You understand your legal rights, is that correct?
I do.
All right. Mr. Daybell, did you receive a cop warrant of arrest as well as the criminal complaint that has been filed here in Fremont County in this case?
Yes.
Mr. Daybell, have you had a chance to review that criminal complaint as well as the arrest warrant with your counsel?
Yes.
Mr. Pryor, I can read the criminal complaint in its entirety, or I can summarize it for you.
Judge, we'll waive actually formal reading of the criminal complaint at this time, and I've discussed that matter with Mr. Daybell, and we're ready to proceed forward without either a summary or a formal reading at this point, Your Honor.
All right. The court is going to summarize briefly what the charges are so that that's on the record, and then we'll address the other issues we need to address. Let me get one more thing out of the way, Mr. Pryor. Ultimately, the Supreme Court order has ordered these hearings be held remotely, but it's my understanding your client is willing to waive his right to be here in court in person. Is that correct?
It is, Your Honor. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Daybell, is that also correct?
Yes.
With regards to the criminal complaint, it was filed dated June 10th, 2020. There are two counts in the criminal complaint. The first count is destruction, alteration, or concealment of evidence, a felony, a violation of Idaho Code 182603. The maximum punishment for that charge is up to 5 years in the state penitentiary and or up to a $10,000 fine. The allegation is that the defendant, Chad Guy Daybell, on or between the 22nd day of September 2019, and the 9th day of June 2020, in the county of Fremont, state of Idaho, did willfully conceal and or aid and abet another to willfully conceal human remains, knowing that said human remains were about to be produced, used, and or discovered as evidence in a felony proceeding, inquiry and or investigation authorized by law with the intent to prevent it from being so produced used, and or discovered. Count two is also the same charge, destruction, alteration, or concealment of evidence, a felony. It's punishable by up to 5 years in the state penitentiary and or up to a $10,000 fine. It alleges that the defendant, Chad Guy Daybell, on or between the 8th day of September 2019 and the 9th day of June 2020, in the county of Fremont, state of Idaho, did willfully destroy, alter, and or conceal human remains, and or did aid and abet another to willfully destroy, alter, and or conceal human remains, knowing that said human remains were about to be produced, used, and or discovered as evidence in a felony proceeding. Inquiry and or investigation authorized by law with the intent to prevent it from being so produced, used, and or discovered. Mr. Daybell, do you understand the allegations on both counts that have been brought against you?
I do.
Mr. Daybell, do you also understand the maximum penalties on each of those counts?
Yes.
Mr. Daybell, do you understand that those maximum penalties could run consecutively, one after the other, or they could run concurrently? Do you understand that?
Yes.
All right. We've gone through the criminal complaint. We've gone through each count. I've advised the defendant of his right. We've gone through that form. Let's discuss the next hearing that's going to be set. Mr. Pryor and Mr. Wood, that next hearing would be a preliminary hearing or a probable cause hearing. The defendant has a right to have that within 14 days if he's incarcerated. It's my understanding that based upon previous conversations that there'll be a waiver of that speedy preliminary hearing. Is that correct, Mr. Pryor?
It is, Your Honor. I've had that discussion with Mr. Daybell. In addition, I've had that discussion with Fremont County Prosecuting Attorney, and at this point, we'll waive the time.
Mr. Wood, is that correct as far as the stipulation?
Yes, the state's fine with that, Your Honor.
Mr. Pryor, the court's going to grant that waiver and acknowledge that it's knowingly and voluntarily made, but I will need a written waiver of speedy preliminary hearing so that that can be in the file for the record. Do you understand?
Yes, Your Honor. I'll do that. Thank you.
All right. With regards to a preliminary hearing, let's first talk about the logistics of that. Mr. Wood, how long do you foresee it taking to accomplish a preliminary hearing in the future?
No longer than a day.
Okay. One day. Mr. Pryor, do you concur with that?
Judge, I'm at a little bit of a disadvantage, but for practical purposes, I think a day would be appropriate.
All right. We'll set this for one day. Mr. Wood and Mr. Pryor, do you have a timeline that you'd like to look at as far as scheduling that today?
Judge, my preference would be within 4 to 6 weeks.
Mr. Wood?
That's fine. We do have a preliminary hearing on July 9th and 10th in the Lori Vallow case. And so if we are going to push it out that far, I'd ask that this prelim be at least the week of the July 16th.
Unfortunately, I'm going to be out of town the week of July 16th, and I won't be back for some time. So if we need to have it in July, it probably needs to be towards the beginning of July or into June. Otherwise, it's going to have to be the last week of July. Mr. Pryor, does that work with your schedule?
Judge, the latter part of June and the first week of July, the first and the second of July would be would be ideal for me if that's available to the court and to Mr. Wood.
We can make that work.
All right, let's look at dates then. I'm looking at the calendar. The end of June, it looks like those Monday is the 29th, and then Tuesday is the 30th, and then Wednesday is July 1st, Thursday, July 2nd. Which of those days did both of you prefer?
I think the 2nd would be best for the state.
Mr. Pryor, does that work for you?
Judge, I believe the 2nd falls on a Friday, if I'm not mistaken. So I would like to see if we could do the 1st, and if necessary, we can have the 2nd available in the event this thing runs a little longer, Your Honor.
Okay, so the 2nd is a Thursday, Mr. Pryor, but I appreciate that you would like to have extra time if it does go over. So if we set it for the first, Mr. Wood, can we do that? And then if it spills over into the second, we'll make sure that date's available.
That'd be fine.
Okay. We'll set that then July 1st and July 2nd for the preliminary hearing or the probable cause hearing. Lastly, the court has issued the arrest warrant. The court designated that it would address bond and or bail at the hearing set today. And so I'd like to hear argument from both parties regarding bail. So why don't I hear from the state first, and then I'll hear from the defense.
Thank you, Your Honor. The state is requesting the bail be set at $1 million. While we recognize that felony concealing of evidence only has a maximum sentence of 5 years per charge, I think the background and context of this case necessitates a higher bail. One of the primary reasons we are asking that bail be set in that amount is that the evidence that has been concealed in this case, it's not simply a document, drugs, a gun. These are human remains. And we can, although those remains have not yet been positively identified, we are aware that those remains are the remains of children, which we believe is an aggravating factor. We have asked that the probable cause affidavit be sealed, but I would ask the court to take note of paragraphs 39 and 40 and the manner of the concealment of one of those bodies, which the state finds to be particularly egregious, both an aggravating factor and bears on character as Rule 40 as Rule 46 allows us to look at. Your Honor, we understand that the possible sentence on this case is not that long, but knowing what the subject matter is, we find it extremely serious. And we'd also note that because of what has been found on Mr. Daybell's property, should he bail out, he has strong incentive to flee. Clearly, this is the beginning now of an investigation into the deaths of children who are found on his property. And so that provides a strong incentive to flee, and we would ask that the bail reflect that. Whatever the court sets as bail, we would ask that the conditions be set that should he bond out, that he be required to wear an ankle monitor, and that his movement be restricted to Madison and Fremont counties.
Thank you, Mr. Wood. Mr. Pryor, I'll hear from you next.
And Judge, for just for purposes of the record, my understanding is the court's allowing us to address this issue of bond, but that in no way limits us in the future to file a further motion for bond if that's necessary. And I believe that's the court's understanding, Mr. Wood's understanding as well, is it not, Judge?
Let me make that clear for the record. Because of the nature of timing and such, generally speaking, the court sets a bail based upon a probable cause affidavit, and then if a motion needs to be filed after, it can be filed. I did not set a bail because, frankly, it was timing. And so, correct, Mr. Pryor, I'm going to give you complete ability to file a renewed motion or a first motion to deal with bail, I guess de novo is how you could look at that. And so I'm going to set bail today. When you file your motion, the court will definitely give you a hearing for that, and we'll take it and make a decision based upon that.
Thank you, Your Honor. But in regards to argument, Your Honor, I would point out that the charges are, as Ms. Ward pointed out, carry a maximum of 5 years. Mr. Daybell is not charged with anything more serious. And quite honestly, for the prosecuting attorney to assume that in the future he may or may not do that, and that we should increase the bail with the idea that in the future there may be something else coming down the pipe, is just clearly contrary to what the purpose of bail is. Bail is to assure that Mr. Daybell shows up to court. Bail is to assure that he's not a flight risk, and there's nothing, as far as I'm concerned, in his history that indicates that he's going to flee the jurisdiction. I would refer the court to the affidavit on number 26, and it talks about the last time that they saw the kids. If Mr. Wood's intention is to pursue further charges, my belief is that he would have pursued those. And quite honestly, at this point, the court needs to take consideration of what the current charges are and whether or not Mr. Daybell will show up to court. Mr. Daybell has taken the initiative to hire private counsel. He has shown up to the proceeding today. Obviously, he's in custody. But Judge, when the police showed up at his house last night, Mr. Daybell didn't flee. Mr. Daybell didn't abscond. Mr. Daybell didn't run. Mr. Daybell's intention was, through his counsel, to turn himself into the court if that was something that was going to happen, and address these issues. He has every intention of addressing these issues. He has significant family in the community. He has kids that live here. He owns property here. And quite honestly, I disagree with Mr. Wood. Mr. Daybell has every intention of staying in the community and every motivation to stay in the community and address these charges. So at this point, Judge, I would ask the court to put the bail at an amount that's appropriate for a 5-year felony sentence. I understand that there's been a significant amount of publicity with this, but publicity is not a reason to raise the bail to an extraordinary amount. And I would suggest that Mr. Wood's suggestion that a $1 million bail is okay, it's not okay, Judge. A $1 million bail is not okay for a 5-year felony sentence. And if in the future Mr. Wood decides to pursue other charges, I'm sure we'll address this again. But at this point, Your Honor, I think it's important for the court to set a bail at an appropriate amount based on the 2 felony 5-year sentences. I would ask the court for $50,000 on each count for a total of $100,000.
Hell no.
Thank you, Mr. Pryor. The court has listened carefully to the argument of both parties. The court has reviewed Idaho Criminal Rule 46, specifically the factors contained in Idaho Criminal Rule 46 under subsection C. There are 10 different factors that the court has looked at. The court has also looked carefully at Idaho Code 192904 and the factors that are designed therein. In looking at the factors in 192904, there are 4 specifically that the legislators have set forth. Number one, ensuring the appearance of the defendant. Number two, ensuring the integrity of the court process, including the right of the defendant to bail as constitutionally provided. Ensuring the protection of victims and witnesses. And number 4, ensuring public safety. The court is cognizant that there is an absolute constitutional right to bail provided in both the Idaho Constitution and the U.S. Constitution. The court has taken all of those factors into account, and based upon those factors and the charge, the court is going to set bail in the amount of $1 million.
Yes.
The court notes that the charge is destruction, alteration, and concealment of evidence as pertained in the criminal complaint. I've taken all those factors into account, specifically the factor in Rule 46C, subsection 6, which designates I'm to take into account the nature of the current charge and any mitigating or aggravating factors that may bear on the likelihood of conviction and the possible penalty. The underlying charge here is destruction, alteration, and concealment of evidence. And the allegation is that the evidence was human remains of 2 different people. That's an aggravating factor, and the court has taken that into account. If bail is posted, Mr. Pryor, I'm also going to make conditions of bail. Those conditions will be as follows. Number one, I'm going to order that a waiver of extradition be provided to the Fremont County Office of the Sheriff. The prosecutor must approve the waiver of extradition by his signature on the waiver of extradition. A copy of that waiver must be filed with the court. Number two, I'm going to order that the defendant shall reside within the boundaries of Bonneville, Jefferson, Madison, and Fremont counties in the state of Idaho. The defendant shall not leave these counties for any reason. Number three, the defendant shall provide the court with his current address and shall not change his address without notifying the court. Number four, the defendant shall keep in regular contact with his attorney. Number five, the defendant shall appear for all court appearances. Number six, the defendant shall obey all laws of the state of Idaho and the United States of America. Number seven, the defendant will sign up for pretrial services and check in with pretrial services here in Fremont County on a weekly basis, as directed. The defendant shall have absolutely no contact with the victim's families and or any of the state's witnesses in this case. Contact shall include, but be not limited to, verbal contact, written contact, visual contact, text messaging contact, email or internet contact, and or telephonic contact. Such contact shall also include contact through third parties. Number nine, the defendant must wear an ankle monitor 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. He must have the ankle monitor in place before he is released from the Fremont County Jail. Any violations of the geographical limitation imposed herein must be reported immediately to the Fremont County Sheriff's Office and the court. If the defendant is notified that under the order to wear the ankle monitor, intentionally leaving the area of restriction, except for the purpose of obtaining emergency medical care, may be prosecuted as a crime of escape and subject the defendant to penalties under Idaho Code. If the defendant fails to comply with all of these terms, the court may, pursuant to Idaho Criminal Rule 46I and Idaho Code Section 29-2919, revoke the defendant's release and eligibility for posting of bail. Mr. Daybell, Mr. Pryor, do both of you understand what bail has been set at, as well as any conditions that must be met in order for that bail to be set?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes.
Mr. Wood, any questions?
No, thank you, Your Honor.
All right, we'll be in recess for today.